Welcome to another edition of Rothenberg Untucked. This is a very busy podcast coming your way today. Dana Cavalea, former Yankee strength and conditioning coach, going to join us. And my question to him is, why are we here with the modern athlete where they're always hurt? I'm so sick and tired of it. And I said to the guys, let's book Dana, and he's going to join us today. How do you follow along on social media? It's easy. On Twitter, at Rothenberg Untucked, R-T-H-N-B-R-G Untucked. Everywhere else, YouTube, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Instagram, TikTok, at Rothenberg Untucked. And what's our website you want to know? I got the answer, www.rothenberguntucked.com. Let's go. Rothenberg Untucked right now. All right, so let's continue the conversation. Dana Cavalea joins us here. Who is he? You say that name sounds familiar. I'm going to tell you why. Former director of strength, conditioning, and performance for your world champion New York Yankees. Helped the club win it all in 2009. Dana, we appreciate you joining us here on Rothenberg Untucked.
Cool. Thanks for having me. Excited to be here.
We have a lot to do. I mean, this could be, I mean, you might want to get dinner and really strap in here because we have a lot to get into. But here's my first question. Everyone that works in the performance field and the body fitness field and the strength and conditioning field, I want to know, and I don't know that there is a right answer, why is it that in this day and age, guys cannot stay healthy? You look at Stanton, you look at Judge, they look like literal Adonises, and 30, 40, 50 years ago, guys never missed a game. Why are we where we are now as opposed to seemingly fine 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago?
Yeah, well, I think you actually answered the question, right? They look like Adonises, right? There's a difference between how you look and how you play. And I believe this. Listen, I'm a guy that, a big part of my role was A, keeping guys healthy, and B, keeping guys strong, powerful, and performing out on the field. And what you see a lot of today is, and you've seen an advancement in training from a protocol standpoint, technology standpoint. But at the same time, we also have to say, is it working, right? We always have to ask the question, no matter what we do in life, is what we are doing working? And personally, what I believe is that there's actually too much focus on the physicality of the player in terms of improving strength and power on athletes that already naturally have that strength and power as a part of their natural skill set and makeup. That's why we drafted them. Like Giancarlo Stanton, as an example, he didn't just start hitting home runs when he got to the big leagues. You know, that's why he was drafted. He was, if you were to look at some of his early scouting reports, I'm sure you would see that he was the type of player that had a very high power profile. And that was something that impressed, you know, the scouts enough and, the GM at the time of the Marlins enough to give him that sort of contract. So there's just a hyper focus on the physicality of training, and it's gone back to where people never wanted it to go. And that's into that football mentality of bigger, stronger, in an attempt to create speed and endurance. And it's sort of an oxymoron.
So what do you do? I mean, if it's just too much, do you, I mean, guys that used to like have part-time jobs in the summer in the 50s, you know, I mean, Mickey Mantle, all these guys, they had other work and they would, I mean, you know, the legendary stories about Mantle, but now guys that spend every minute working on their physiques and their bodies are breaking down. Do you tell them take time off? Is that the appropriate thing to do?
Well, again, you're laying up a lot of great questions here because you said it again, right?
That's they're just spending, what I do. I mean, I'm an interviewer.
They're spending all of this time working on their body, right? So there's time to work on the body, and there's also time where the body has to heal, recover, and regenerate from the work in which you give it. So here you are playing a game, right? And most people think the game is just 7 p.m., you know, through the last pitch, and it's not. Because players typically get to a ballpark around between 1 and 2 o'clock and they start working their bodies, right? Physically working from a strength and performance standpoint, working the tissue in terms of what goes on in an athletic training room. Then they go and they do T work. They do extra infield. They do all of this work. Then they stretch. Then they run. All of this. All of that has a toll on the body's physicality. So if all you're doing is working the body and you're not giving the body enough recovery, how do you recover? And when is the body at most risk for injury and breakdown? When it's overworked, fatigued, and under-recovered. So when you take all of that knowledge, right there, and you also take the knowledge of who is at the greatest risk of injury, a player that's previously been injured, well, now you have a very, very dangerous combination. You have players now with big injury histories, and the best metric one can have to predict future injury is previous injury. So you got previous injury.
Yep.
You have high volume of training, minimal recovery, and high expectations. That's a bad combination.
So if let's just put you back into Major League Baseball, and not even with the Yankees, but you're working with we'll just say a random team. Are you personally going to do it differently than it's being done right now? The philosophy that you bring to the table is different than what you see Major League Baseball doing at the moment.
My philosophy has always been different than what went on or goes on in Major League Baseball, because I always looked at it like this. Again, when you come at it from the position of you already have a very high performing athlete, your job, your duty, your goal is to deploy that talent as frequently as possible, 7 p.m. during the week, 1 p.m. on the weekend. The whole idea is to make sure that your protocols are not about growth and build and development, but they're actually built on recovery and understanding the athlete's body to see where the body is off balance. So what I would do with players is I would measure rotation in the hips. How much do they have? Rotation in the shoulders. How much do they have? You know, are their leg lengths, are they even? Because these guys are like Formula One race cars. They go around the track once, they're fine. They go around again, something's off. Yep. They go around again, something new is off. So it is a constant maintenance strategy that needs to be deployed to keep these players on the field, more so than a constant development strategy. When you're in the big leagues, these players are already developed. We have to allow them the opportunity to showcase the talent that they're being paid to showcase every night by keeping them balanced, keeping them stable, keeping them recovered, and putting them on a plan, a strategic plan to do that each and every day. So the long answer is I always made the majority of my programming about rebalancing, fatigue management, and then I'd have 20% that was dedicated to strength, maintenance, and a little bit of build. But that was not the primary focus of the program. And I believe today that that's the primary focus of the program. Just look at Instagram accounts of most players in the offseason. What are they doing? Building, building, building with high volume, high intensity, and high speed. And that is a disaster recipe.
So for argument's sake, let's just say that you're the GM of the Yankees and, you know, Aaron Judge's deal. I know it comes with a lot of stress and a lot of headaches, but for argument's sake, Aaron Judge's deal is coming up and he's going to be a free agent. Would you really think twice about signing him to a 7-year, God knows how many million dollar contract, knowing that at the late 20s, he's already had moments where he's breaking down?
Previous injury is the greatest indicator of future injury. So, and when you take previous injury history and combine it with age, where your tissue becomes a little bit more rigid, where your tissue goes from filet mignon to beef jerky, it's a little more crackly. I think that answers the question. And that's not just for Aaron Judge. For me, that's for any player that you look at as a GM, whether it's the Yankees GM, whether it's the Mets GM, any GM. When you look at a player and you say, hey, they've been hurt chronically, the chances of them not being hurt in the future, it's very low. They're actually giving you high levels of predictability into the future and forecasting. It's up to you to believe it. But to expect a miracle from your training staff to keep an unhealthy player healthy, I think is very poor. So for me, I would never sign a player to a long-term deal that's had a huge injury history, because I just think it's a bad return on investment. Now, again, teams are going to evaluate that decision differently than somebody like me who's just looking at injury history and what the future brings. Some teams know that a player's at high risk, but they know that the fan value, and they're willing to pay for that. So that's where things get a little bit sticky.
So you expect Stanton, I mean, this is what he is, early 30s, can't even play the field. They went to Philadelphia, and they couldn't even play him in these games because he just can't play in the outfield, even on grass. This is what we're in for? I mean, are we in for another 6 years of he's hurt?
Pujols, in many ways. Albert Pujols, same kind of
– yeah.
Remember he signed that big contract
with,
you know, with Anaheim, and his playing days on the field diminished over time, more and more and more and more, until, you know, they let him out to pasture.
Yeah, it really is remarkable where we are. So where does this stem from? Is this like youth sports? Do you see this as a almost a systemic problem where lunatic parents, probably like myself, are starting their kids so young and just pounding it into their heads that bigger, faster, stronger, never take a day off, grind, grind, grind? Like, is that the genesis of the problems that we have right now?
I think it's a starting point of the problem. I think you have players that are single sport players. They're not athletes, they're baseball players. You know, they're not athletes, they're basketball players. They just play that one sport. And in playing multiple sports, each skill set builds upon itself and they build upon each other, giving you a player that is really just athletic. Like when you study the profile of a Derek Jeter and of a Mariano Rivera, you had very athletic men, right? They were very athletic. A-Rod, very athletic. They just happened to channel that athleticism towards baseball, where they were able to really excel once they became specialized as they got older. So it's the lack of multi-sport. That's a big issue. And as it relates to the injuries, you're also seeing what happens when you overload one particular pattern or two particular patterns of the body. So if you're a right-handed thrower, just even if you were to simulate a throw for yourself, what's happening from a musculoskeletal standpoint on one side of the body is the opposite of what's happening on the other side of the body. So you're creating this asymmetry starting at a young age. So you're reinforcing asymmetrical patterns as the player ages out. And that's when it becomes more and more of an issue. So we didn't see those issues as much years ago because players didn't specialize until later in their youth career.
So should I demand that both of my kids, because they're both, the oldest one's focused on baseball, youngest one lacrosse, should I demand that you have to at least do something else some part of the season?
I believe that that's a great demand to have, you know, because of what it'll do in terms of balancing them out from a physicality standpoint, but it'll also make them a better athlete. You know, you study great athletes, you know, again, some of the guys that I mentioned, Mariano Rivera as a soccer player, his ability, foot control, ball control, body control is stellar. That's why, you know, if you would back in the day, you'd go watch Mo before a game, he'd field, you know, he'd play outfield. You know, and he'd be power shagging every day. His movements, how he would get to a ball was amazing. He just happened to pitch, right? That was his thing. But he was right. A very talented athlete. And that's what I believe many players could benefit from. But that doesn't correct the problem, you know, that's going on currently in the big leagues. It just could prevent it later on, the problem that will happen in the big leagues.
So at what point, because baseball is it feels like they're always kind of behind the curve and, you know, things happen and then they react to it as opposed to being proactive. At what point do some of the strength and conditioning and training coaches say, you know what, it's too much, like we have to dumb it down. We have to kind of go in the direction of what Dana tells us to do, because otherwise all these injuries will just continue. Like, do you think we're close to that, or are we years away from that happening?
I think we're years away from that. And what's really interesting, again, like I said, there's new technologies, there's new ways to evaluate and assess. There's data and analytics, not just on field, but, you know, that takes place behind the scenes. But the issue is this, the protocols for training are still the same. So we have all these data points now, but we still use the same training measures and methods on the player, right? A squat, players are still squatting. They were squatting 10 years ago. but now we have all this data. What are we doing with the data, and how functional and usable is the data? How necessary is it? And is the data telling us the right things? Is it telling us what we need to know? Is the data translating to the skill set of a coach that can manipulate variables, manipulate training protocols, develop new training protocols based on that in data and the interpretation of it?
Am I right when I look at the guys of 40, 50, 60 years ago, the Tom Seavers, the Goose Gossages, the certainly Cal Ripkins, and to think they never got hurt? Or are we in a generation where you know everything, every minute that's happening with social media and Twitter and beat reporters, and maybe it's just more known now? Or is it truly very different now than it was?
You know, I got a buddy of mine. He runs a private aviation company called Wheels Up. And he said, you know, the more you sleep in satin sheets, the later you sleep. And that's, I believe, what's happening here. You know, you're paying players very early. Why go out there and play that game if you don't feel 100%? Back in the day, they had to play the game. The game was where they monetized. That game mattered. Today, not as many games matter because guys are already financially stable. Sometimes, you know, right after high school, come draft time. So I believe when the infusion of money came in, bonus babies got bigger and bigger, it started to change a lot. And what happened was, too, I remember this, one of the early players that came into the league was Phil Hughes. And he was the first player that really made a lot of money, especially in the organization, you know, the Yankees organization. And we had to be more delicate with him because he was a player that was paid more than anybody else. So we were, you know, there was a lot invested into him. And it's amazing how you get more gentle sometimes when you have a high asset player. You know, we think that we rest them more and we'll get more out of them. We don't push them as hard and we get more out of them. But also that's not always the case either.
So you were part of it, and your job at the time was director of strength and conditioning and performance for the Yankees back in 2009. Give me something. Bring me back into the clubhouse. Bring me back to a story. Is there a Jeter? Is there an A-Rod? Is there a somebody? Give me something that brings me back into that locker room that people are like, wow, that's a story. Dana really gave us something there.
Yeah, well, the biggest thing is, you know, when you put those guys in the room, you know, and we had Tex and we had AJ and we had CeCe join us, you had a group of guys that wanted to do nothing more than win. That's all we wanted to do. And there wasn't this sit at your locker and sit on Twitter and sit at your locker and go on the gram and all that. We literally just showed up every day to win. That's what everybody loved to do. And, you know, I was at dinner the other night with Tex, Mark Teixeira, and we were talking about, you know, after we won the World Series, how everybody went to this club, One Oak, down in the city, and we were just partying through the night, and it was the greatest feeling of victory. And today, the question is everybody playing for themselves in the contract, or are they playing to actually feel that feeling of victory and the love for that feeling over and over and over and over again? You know, when it comes to those stories, I mean, that was the story. We just love to win. It was an amazing thing.
So I asked you a lot today about the injuries and keeping guys healthy and how that's changed. But it sounds like you think the athlete and just the athlete's mindset is different, even having nothing to do with the physical way that they play.
I think the players today have a lot of leverage that maybe they didn't have years ago, too. You know, these guys are brands. They're companies in their own right just based on their annual revenues and contract values. And I just think there's just a different mentality. The game is the same, but the players are a bit different. The focus is a bit different. The compensation's a bit different. And I believe everything around that has adjusted. And that's why you're looking at things. You're seeing some things today that you didn't see 20, 30 years ago, 10 years ago. It's just different. And I think as a fan and as a spectator too, you have to make a decision. Is this the game for you that you enjoy watching? Or would you rather watch the classics from years ago and appreciate some of the finer things that took place, from player grit to player attitude to the chip on the shoulder that players had years ago, to the little things, moving guys over, double steals, stealing bases, bunts, the little game, right? Joe Torre would always say pitching and defense wins championships. Today, the mentality a lot of times is home runs and power profiles are very seductive. Let's try to go that way to win a championship. But, you know, it's the same game with a very different culture today.
You have taken athletes, non-athletes, CEOs, and turned them into, you know, really conditioned individuals. Someone like me, a guy that's, I wouldn't say completely out of shape, but somewhat out of shape, a little bit overweight. If I went to you and said, all right, I'm a piece of clay, mold me, how long before you turn me into like a lean, mean fighting machine?
Well, it depends on the effort in which you put in, right? A coach is
very minimal effort. I'm probably going to give you very minimal effort.
Yeah. Well, you know, what you get in, you get out. So, but ultimately, you know, when it comes to anybody changing their game, and I say, you know, unleashing their inner champion, you know, whether it's from a physical standpoint or a mental standpoint, it's a daily process. And it's not so much about hyper-focusing on outcome. It's about hyper-focusing on the day-to-day process to get you to the desired outcome. So you cast a vision, you cast a goal. This is what I want to do. This is what I want to become. And then you get to work on that day-to-day program. And that's the same thing we do with professional athletes. And now, again, I'm fortunate enough to do it with CEOs, executives, leaders in finance, and entrepreneurs. And it's very cool because most folks in those categories, they've never been exposed to any of this. See, many athletes, they take this for granted until they, you know, or when they retire, it finally strikes them that when you're coached every single day on behaviors, on what it is you do, outcomes, you're constantly being tweaked, that gets you a result. And it makes you, puts you in the mindset and in the being that you're getting better every single day because you actually are. And most people don't have that luxury, but they could.
So how is this something that you get into? Like how you're like, you know, a strength and conditioning to the stars at this point. Like the CEOs, you talk about wheels up. You were with the Yankees when you were really young. How did this materialize?
Well, you know, for me, I got into coaching because I was an underperforming player and I valued coaching. I had great coaches that were able to wring out the sponge and get every last drop of talent out of me. And I had other coaches that I felt helped pull me back because they didn't give me the confidence and I didn't give myself the confidence. But ultimately I got into this, especially the executive coaching by accident. You know, one of the benefits of working for the Yankees is we get a lot of VIP guests. We get a lot of prominent New York business folks and business leaders that come to games. So I would always watch batting practice from behind the shell and I'd get a lot of VIP guests that say, hey coach, I'm having problems sleeping. I'm having problems with stress. How do I lose this 15, 20 pounds? I'm real negative. I get down on myself. What do you have for me? And I would just converse with them. And then I would end up on Joe's show, Yankee Magazine here and there. And they'd take to that. And one day I actually had a gentleman come up to me and say, hey, do you work with rich Jewish guys? And I said, joking around, I said, well, it depends how much they pay. And anyway, he called me a week later. He ends up being a team owner of an NBA sports team. And that kicked off my executive coaching business in addition to working with the Yankees. So it was very cool. And it's just organically grown from there.
What is the one thing that the modern athlete is doing too much of that they just should not be doing?
You know, and it's funny that I'm going to use this name, you know, in what I'm going to say, but, you know,
name drop, give us names. Yes. Give us names.
You know, A-Rod told me this years ago when he was playing, and this, again, during our era, there was not as much social media and there wasn't as much discussion on my personal brand. The brand that you played for was on your chest. That was always the case. But I remember Alex saying this, and I mean, now he's obviously a social media darling. But for me, it's staying off of social media and thinking about your personal brand at the level in which many think about their personal brand. So, you know, being on social media all day, and I'll tell you this, you know, there's also a fatigue component that comes with it. Just because somebody's a pro athlete doesn't mean they're immune to the same things that many of us, in the general population, you know, deal with. When you sit on your phone all day, you fatigue out. When you sit on your phone all day, your neck is contorted, your shoulders are contorted, you're often sitting, right? So the modern athlete spends a lot of time doing things outside of being great at what it is that they do. They spend a lot of time outside of being great baseball players. So Alex said this. He said, listen, I know where I monetize. I monetize on the field, and there is no commercial that's ever going to pay me what I can make on the field. And I just tell every player that I work with that, remember where you monetize and remember who pays you and where you have the opportunity to be great. And that'll always be on the field.
And there's a lot of negativity on social media. I mean, my God, you know, I'm on it like a fraction of what these guys are because I, you know, host a show in New York City. And I mean, people will go after anything with the athlete. It's got to be well worse than that.
Yeah. And if you start to believe it, think about what that could do to your overall performance. I mean, these guys, people don't know this, but professional athletes for the most part are they're sensitive. They don't like when you say something, you know, not nice about them. They feel that too. You know, I remember years ago, I was sitting in our clubhouse. I'm sitting in the food room. I got there early and I open up the New York Post and I'm reading it. You know, I was probably reading page 6 more so than the sports section. But all of a sudden, a hand comes and grabs it out of my hand. And I look up and it's Derek Jeter. And he says, Dana, don't read that. I said, why? He goes, they never say anything good about us. And it's true. He said, I stopped reading that 10 years ago. So not to put down the Post, I enjoy the paper, you know, looking at, you know, some of the fanfare, but for the most part, it's again, you got to keep your mind strong. You got to keep your mind clean and you got to stay focused. So anything that the modern day player could do to stay away from those negative inputs will help them.
We greatly appreciate it. Continued success to you with everything that you're doing, and hopefully we'll get a chance to do this again at some time in the future.
Absolutely. Thank you.
All right, Dana, great stuff, man. It's now time for everyone's favorite segment, Stump Rothenberg. We start out with one Joe Villalone. Joe, before we start with Stump Rothenberg, I'm noticing something because I'm ultra aware. Is that an Untucked shirt you're wearing?
It certainly is, and I want to thank you for it. I used code word Dave and saved big cake.
Yes, that's
on my purchase.
20%. So everyone out there, Father's Day on the horizon, Untucked shirt. You can look as spiffy and dapper as both Joe and myself right now, and you can have a lot of money to buy additional Father's Day presents. Go to untucked.com. And use bonus code DAVE. Doesn't save you 12%. Not 15, not 18. No. 20% off your first order. You're making a tremendous mistake if you don't go to untuckit.com. All right, Joe. Your question today on Stump Rothenberg.
You know, David, athletes make a lot of money.
Yes.
They do.
But they can still use the bonus code DAVE to save 20% at Untuckit.
Sure.
Yes.
They probably do volume order.
I believe that that's true, yes.
Yes. I was reading an interesting article, Forbes, from May 20 to May 21st. That's the calendar year that they use. The top earning athletes in the world.
Now, are we including their off the field finances?
Yes, you are.
So commercials, products.
Big investments into liquor companies. That seems to be paying off for people.
Okay, we should open
wildly.
A liquor company. Yes.
Tequila.
Yes, I believe so, with the Mark Wahlberg type. All right, so give me the exact question of what you're asking me.
The question is, can you name three of the top five top-earning athletes?
Okay, all right.
From May 20 to May 21. That's the calendar year.
Okay, so the calendar year from May of 2020 to May of 2021.
Three of the top
four. Yes. Okay. All right. Soccer has to be involved. I'm going to go Cristiano Ronaldo.
Yes.
Yes.
120 million, 70 million of which was salary.
Okay. Lionel Messi.
Yes. He's number two at 130 million, 97 million of which was salary.
So I'm 2 for 2. So I need to get one of the next three to achieve success in this question.
Two of them.
No, I don't want hints.
Okay.
LeBron James.
Yes.
Yes.
He's number 5.
Okay. So I'm missing 1 and 4?
Yes, you are. He was 96.5 million, 31.5 million of which was salary.
So he made a lot more money off the field than he did on.
He did.
All right. Number 4.
NFL.
Dak Prescott.
How did you know that?
Because he just signed this whopping new deal. He gets a bundle off the field.
That is correct.
I don't appreciate you doubting my knowledge either.
$107 million, $66 million signing bonus, gave him $97 million.
And I think I'm going to sweep this here.
Okay.
Conor McGregor.
Yes.
He asked for 3, 5 for 5 on Stump
Rothenberg. Very well done.
That was wonderful.
By you today.
Next up on Stump Rothenberg, Max. Hello, Max.
Hi, Dave.
How are you?
I'm good.
Good. What do you got?
Okay. So today, I got a pop culture question for
you.
Okay. It's about Star Wars.
Uh-oh. This is not going to be good for me.
Well, you might know it. You might not.
I don't know, but go ahead.
Okay. So pay attention to the question.
Okay.
1977. Who portrayed Darth Vader?
James Earl Jones.
Close. He voiced Darth Vader. The guy who betrayed him, though, David Prowse.
Oh, yeah, no, I had no idea.
David Prowse, English bodybuilder.
Oh.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, you win. Congratulations. Next up, we bring in Jake.
So a lot of nations have their own set determined sports, right, that the nation itself declares as the national sport.
National sport.
And Canada is very unique in the fact that it has two, one for winter, one for summer. Obviously winter, I mean, I'm sure you can guess, it's hockey.
Yeah.
Right, yeah, because they're dominant. What's the summer sport nationally for Canada?
Lacrosse.
Of course, you got that immediately. Can I give you a follow-up one?
No, absolutely not. All right, let's bring him in. He is TJ. Hello, TJ.
How are you, Dave?
I am fine. What do you got today?
David Tyree, our man. The helmet master.
Yes.
How many years did he play in the NFL after his famous catch?
See, the way you lead this is that that was it, but I don't think that was it. I'm going to say 2.
That's it. He played 2 seasons.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
How many catches did he have after that helmet catch?
This is quite the question, TJ. Now you'd think 0. But I don't know if that's going to be right. I'm either 0 or I'm like 4. What did we say? That was his last ever catch in the NFL? The answer to that would be 0, TJ.
Dave, you are correct. That was his last catch in the NFL.
Do you realize the genius that you're working with here on Rothenberg Untucked? And you can consume this product anywhere you'd like on Twitter at RTHNBRG. Untucked, YouTube, Rothenberg Untucked, Spotify, Rothenberg Untucked, Apple Podcast, you get the theme, Rothenberg Untucked, Instagram, Rothenberg Untucked, and say it with me, TikTok, Rothenberg Untucked, website, www.rothenberguntucked.com. Big thanks to Dana Cavalea, it was excellent with him, Stump Rothenberg, story time, all of it. Make sure you join us next week on Rothenberg Untucked.